Conditions, but in all of that, it's not because I'm better, it's not because God favors me or loves me more, but it is His mercy and His grace that has kept me alive, and I do not take it for granted. I remember here two years ago, 2016, I came and I said I was starting my master's in social work. I just want to give God all the praise. At the end of this month, I will be finished.
Amen. Amen.
2 years has flown, it has gone. A lot of struggles, a lot of things has come my way, but God has still kept me.
Amen.
God saw me through my first year. I did not fail any module. I passed every single one.
Amen.
And so shall it be for this second year. Amen. As I finish, God be the glory. By September, I will be a qualified social worker.
Yeah.
I am taking for granted. How God paid my fees, I don't know, but God provided.
Amen.
I'm not owing my university. God made a way for me where there seemed to be no way.
Amen.
I don't take it for granted. Amen. I thank God for my family home and abroad. I thank God for my family back in Ireland, my family members in Nigeria. I'm on my own here in the United Kingdom. Sometimes I feel like, wow. When you're alone in a country, that's when you want to just go astray. You wanna, because nobody's looking at you. No parents, no siblings, nobody's watching you. But I told myself, God is watching me.
Amen.
If I go against His will and anything happens, it's my problem. But God has kept me in this country for 4 years. I've been doing His will. I've been working in His ways. I've been doing things to please God. Most of the times when I go astray, I bring myself back with prayer and supplication. I just want to say thank you, Jesus, for a year that you've given unto my life in good health. I am grateful. Thank you for this church. I cannot but thank Pastor Nikki and Pastor Abby. They have helped me so much with the counseling we're going through. A lot of things that they've been, you know, guiding myself and Ola. I just want to give God all the praise. And at the end of it, everything will work out for our own good.
Amen.
And good news is coming soon.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah. Another one. The whole idea of listening to testimonies is for you to know where their people are coming from to where you see them today. And you can be the judge or the witness to where you are going to see them tomorrow. You see? First year has gone for her in the MSc that she's doing. And I believe that the same God will see her through the second year. Well, she says she's alone. What about brother in Ghana is there? For now, you will understand. For now. Our sister is going to get married very soon.
Amen.
And we'll all be invited.
Amen.
Okay? So we look forward to that. So we've been having a marriage counseling for the two of them. And we've been praying for them. not to miss the mark. You know, that they can all arrive at the destination together. The destination where Christ is. So that when they start having their own children, you will see them.
Amen.
See? Maybe twins first. Yeah. And you will help them to carry, just as you help Mrs. Tati. You know, those are the things. For everyone that is in this church, really, I've seen it happen over and over again. That when we begin to pray for them for the fruit of the womb, they will end up having twins.
Amen.
For the glory of God. Well, you don't want me to pray for you, so because you don't want to have twins. So I don't mind, I still pray for singleton. Okay? You said that one now. Don't mind. She said she wants triplets. Okay. She told God that she doesn't need that anymore because leave that to other people that are coming on board. Sister Leonie is still there.
Yes.
Coming on board. And Sister Uche, Sister Amarash.
And Sister Julia.
Sister Julia is also there. You know? We're all waiting for the right man.
Yes.
But the truth of the matter is, I've found out, if your heart is right, God will not allow the wrong people to come your way. He won't. I can speak that of my own. God has given me the most beautiful woman. My love, my head is swelled up. But it's the truth, this is real. Because I knew what it took me at that time. And I had to walk with God. And today is a testimony. Lovely children as well. So we thank God for that. So marriage doesn't have to be hell or hellish. No. Though there will be challenges, but in the midst of it, God is still there. And that is the reason why there are challenges. It's because God is there. If God is not there, then we'll just bombard you, panel beat you, do everything to you. But because God is in the house, in that relationship, the enemy also wants you to lose that connection with God. So if I were you, I would not take my focus away from God. There is no two people, there are no two people that are the same. There is always room for improvement. Alright, some improvement will take place quickly, some will take years. I've told you not to do that before. Okay? You've done it again. Alright. But that's love. Okay? Praise God. Anyway, today is not marriage seminar, okay? But it's one of those things. Well, time has gone, so we have to continue with the word of God very quickly. So if you're interested in that, not just testimonies, you're interested in the real testimony, which is the word of God. Let's bring out your Bibles, as I always tell you, and your writing material. Because if you have a leader, you must look at your leader to know whether to know where you're going. So if you don't have leaders that are going the right direction and you are there, then obviously you don't know where you're going. But if you have leaders and you know that they are going the right direction, then you are there to follow suit. Paul said, follow me, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Christ is our leader, the great teacher. Christ is the one that is our savior. Christ is the one that we are following. But underneath Christ, he will put some under shepherd there to guide us in the word of God. And the onus is on us not to just be following them sheepishly, but to follow them with intelligence or with intellect, to follow them with sense. Follow them consciously so that you can know how your life is going to be in some years time. You see, because in these days, devil is trying to cheat everyone, trying to deceive people by saying that I go to church. But I find that just going to church is not enough. But being a believer in the word of God. Every one of us, we are gifted in one area or the other. When you discover your gifts or your own gifting area, then your life becomes fulfilled. Or if you are just following people and you don't know who you really are, then you'll be singing song of you'll be singing God's song in a strange land. See? Well, we all have our identity discovered in Christ Jesus. That's where we begin to build our lives from. Rather than just coming to church, listen to the sermon, and then go back, and nothing has happened. But that will not be your portion in Jesus' name. Yeah. So Father, we thank you for your awesome presence. Thank you for your word. Now we want to go into your word. Please help us open the eyes of our inner man to know what exactly you have for us inside this word of God, the Bible. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Romans chapter 6 verse 1. Romans chapter 6 verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? This is a scripture that I would like you to know what led to this statement. We've done the book of Romans before. And then it is my expectation that for those that have been taught the book of Romans, they will go back there again so that they can find out the truth out of it. This is a question in response to the previous verse. That is in chapter 5, verse 20. Moreover, that is more than this, the law entered that the offense might abound. The law entered. The reason why the law came was to show you and I our deficiency in God. And in doing so, it actually unveiled our sinfulness. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. So with the arrival of the law, it actually unveiled our sinfulness and our separation away from God. But where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. So the law of Moses made mankind to be aware of sin. The law made us aware of sin, and it put us deeper into sin. And we're looking for ways to come out of it. We could not live right because the law revealed to us that we were sinners. We were sinners before we came to Christ. But where sin abounded, take note of that. Where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. This is not a license to sin. But the grace we are talking about is the involvement of God to help us each time to overcome the sin. The grace came so that we can overcome sin. And that grace is the Lord Jesus Christ. The grace through God came to us through Christ. So God gives more grace so that you and I can live without sin. But he only gives more grace to the humble, to those that are really, really sincere and genuinely are tired of the life they are living because they know something is better. But they cannot get to that better lifestyle unless through God. And God gives them more grace so that they can achieve that expectation. But only in Christ can you live without sin. So it is possible to live without sin. Don't go by the idea that everyone in this world, we are sinners. We were sinners. You and I were sinners until Christ. But you are no longer a sinner when you are in Christ, because the nature of sin has died, has been removed. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is the reason why Christ came. Otherwise, it becomes a religious day. Every Easter, we celebrate, and every Resurrection Day, we also remember Christ, and then we put it back into the archive again. It ought to be a lifestyle. Christ has led us, given us a precedent so that we know what is expected of us in the new living way that he has brought us. The people without Christ are living in sin because they have no power to deal with sin. They can't help it. But you and I can. We have the power, the choice not to live in sin. I can choose not to lie. I choose rather not to lie. I choose not to lie. I choose to speak the truth. That's because I am under the grace of God. Before now, I have no power. One Bible translation reads in verse 20 to 21, God's law was given so that all people could see how sinful they were. But as people sinned more and more, God's wonderful grace became more abundant. Verse 21, so that as sin reigned in death, verse 21, so that as sin reigned in death, see, the wages of sin is what? Death. Death will separate you from God. Death will separate you from life. Same way sin will separate you from God. And that is that terrible feeling that you can feel when you sin against God. Take for instance, you as a believer, you told a lie. You feel that terrible sensation in you that something is amiss. Because that is not the life that God wants you to live as a believer. So Paul is saying there that as sin reigned in death, sin would lead to death, separation from life. Even though you have not died physically, but spiritually you have been cut off. Everybody say cut off.
Cut off.
And that is why you have that nasty feeling. Especially when you have done something nasty as a believer. One translation reads in that verse 21, so just as sin ruled over all people, sin ruled over all people in the past tense, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But that might not be you when you have, if you have made Jesus your Lord and Savior. But he's looking at this before we all started, before we all knew Christ. So just as sin ruled over all people and brought them to death, now God's wonderful grace rules instead, giving us right standing with God and resulting in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And that's what he says there. Even so, that is now, grace might reign through righteousness. It's only by the grace of God that you know now what is right to do. And that grace that is reigning in you through righteousness will produce in you eternal life. Every time you do it right to please God, you have life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, there is no life outside Christ. Do I get an amen?
Amen.
Chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. Now you understand why Paul began that chapter with this question. What shall we say then? What shall we say then? Because he knows where sin abound, even grace abound more. But that is not a license for you to sin. Rather, the grace will abound more for you to deal with sin. What shall we say then? Or you say, what then shall we say? Shall we continue in sin so that grace may abound? Should we keep on sinning so that God can show us more and more of his wonderful grace? Certainly not. Verse 2. How shall we, hallelujah, How shall we who died to sin in the past tense? When you are in Christ Jesus, you have died to sin, not just because you are a church goer. Because there are many church goers that are not in Christ. That's a mystery. But when you are in Christ Jesus, you have died to sin. Say, certainly not. How shall we who died, everyone says, say to me, who died?
Who died?
It means say who is going to die. How can we who died, that is who have died, how can I that have died to sin continue to be living in sin? Some of us are still living in sin because we have not died to sin. If you have not yet died to sin, then sin is still ruling over you. That's why habitually you can tell a lie. You tell a lie. Habitually you are telling somebody something that you yourself are not doing. Habitually you are showing others that you are not faithful. You know? But you still come to church. So you're just wasting your time. See? So that the things you know are right, you don't do. The things you know are wrong is what you do. That is sinfulness. Verse 6-7, please. Verses 6-7. Knowing this, that our old man, everyone say to me, old man.
Old man.
You see, you and I, we had an old man. I had an old man. An old man of me was the one that did not know Christ before now. The old man of me was the one that died with Christ when Christ died on the cross. My old man was the one that used to live that life I lived before. So you too, you have an old man. The way you used to live before you now say you are in Christ. So I knew where my old man was crucified. And I knew now, and now know the new man that is in me. So is that the same thing with you? Or you are just playing church? So this is what we are talking about. And this is what Paul was saying. That know this, that our old man was crucified. Everybody say, was crucified.
Was crucified.
In the past tense. Because that was what we did some few days ago when we remembered the death of Christ on the cross. Was crucified with him, with Christ. That the body of sin, everybody say body of sin.
Body of sin.
The body of sin is the one that doesn't have any choice but to sin. I don't want to do it, but I still did it. That's the body of sin. That body of sin will still be there unless you are in Christ. That body of sin will still be there unless you willingly dropped it and said, today I surrender all to Christ. But you cannot hide. You can still be in the church. You know that the body of sin is still in you. So you cannot do what Christ wants you to do. You need to repent. Know this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with. Everyone say, done away with. When you and I gave our lives to Christ, when I gave my heart to Christ, the body of sin was done away with. Yes. I don't know the body of sin in your own life. So if you are still doing those sin, then you have not yet, your body of sin is still in you, on you. You have not yet met Christ. You are just religious. That the body of sin might be done away with. That is why, says, when the body of sin is done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. Gone are the days when you say, no, over my dead body, I will never forgive you. Do you know what you did to me? I won't do, no. That was the body of sin. Gone. Done away with. I don't talk to that one. I don't go out to that one. That one is, no. That was dead. God wants you to now have the newness of life, but only in Christ. Because those people that are doing that are the ones that are slaves of sin. They are living in disobedience to God. We don't have them right now in this church. People that are disobeying God. People that will know what the Bible is saying, but they will do the opposite. Do we have them here? No, we don't have them here. Because the scripture must be fulfilled. It said that the body of sin might be what? Done away with. What I used to do before, I cannot do it again. The lifestyle I used to live, I cannot live it again. Those nasty friends, I cannot go out with them again. Because every time I go out with them, they always bring me back to go back as if a dog went back to vomit. I don't want to do that. Are you following?
Yes.
Because it takes dying to live. Unless the body of sin is done away with, unless you are ready to die to sin, you are not yet alive. This is what we're talking about, our spiritual life. When you have that spiritual life, you are walking together with God. He will show you the things to come. Verse 7. Are you following?
Yes.
Verse 7, please. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I didn't write the Bible, but I can make you understand this through the help of the Holy Spirit. Unless you have died, you cannot come alive. He who has died, he who has died, let that say, he who has died to sin has been freed from sin. So when I am free, I am saying I'm free. Can you see? You will show in your lifestyle that you are free. That's the song. I am free to dance. I am free to sing. It's not true. Some people that are singing that, they are not free. When you are saying, I am free to dance, because you knew that before now, you cannot dance. So you can see many of the time we sing the song, but we don't understand the song. Bible says, would you sing, would you praise God with understanding? Many people are praising God with lip service. God help us.
Amen.
Today's title, freedom from sin.
Amen.
Until you are dead, you cannot be freed from sin. You will still be lying. You will still be watching pornography. Nothing more. Yes, you see how your friends, what are they talking about? Rubbish. But when you are freed from sin, all those things sound like acabos. Did I get that right? What is that thing that we give people drunkards? Drunk people, that when they taste drink again, it's tasteless. Sister Tokes is not here today. What is that thing? You see, in medical, how interesting. God will just give you an example of so many things. We have a psychiatrist among us, but she's not here today. In mental education, in psychiatry, see, people that are having problem with alcohol. I thought we have nurses. What's the Acabos or something like that?
No, Acabos is old tablet for diabetes. This is
called Dioxide. No, that's not the one I want. The one I want begins with an A, whereby when you take that medication, it's to help people that are drunk, addicted to drinks, mm-hmm. alcohol. When they take that medication, every time they now go back to want to sneak to drink alcohol, mm-hmm. it becomes
sick.
They become sick. Mm-hmm. That's it. So that's the name I'm trying to get to. So those are the things. So when we have died to sin, the point is that when you have died to sin, because you have died to sin,
mm-hmm.
right, you are free from sin. When people that are sinning come close to you, you see, those things will make you feel sick. That's why David said, blessed are those that does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. When people are making jest of God, it makes you feel sick. You can't even stay with them. They are your friend, they used to be, but now you draw a line. That's what I'm talking about. Freedom from sin. Verse 9. Knowing that Christ having been raised from the dead, did you hear that? Did he say that Christ will be raised from the dead?
No.
This is English. Christ having been raised from the dead. Hallelujah. Dies no more. When Christ died on the cross and was buried and then rose from the dead, death has been defeated.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen?
Same way, sin has been defeated.
Amen.
In your life. If you really been crucified with Christ. So, when people that are sinning, or they suggest you to tell a lie, you just repel it. You don't welcome them more. You tell them, I don't do this. It doesn't matter if you lose friends, so long you don't lose God. That is what we're talking about. When you begin to do what I'm talking about, then you are living the new life.
Amen.
Which Christ has paid for us. I'm not talking about being a church member. This is more than church. This is the new life in Christ. One Bible translation reads verse 20 to 21. No, let's leave that. In that verse 9, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. So Jesus Christ is not going to come back and save us. We have been saved. We have been delivered from sin, from Satan, and from sickness.
Amen.
Death was swallowed up in victory. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Christ can therefore die no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. Verse 10. For the death that he died. Did you see that he died? Because some people did not know that he died. He died. For the death that he died to sin once for all. Once for all. Christ can no more die because he is freed from sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Dying to sin will free you from sin. When you are still struggling, it's because you have not died. Just say, God, I want to die. I want to die to sin. So is that a good prayer? God, I want to die to sin. Is that not a good prayer?
Yes,
may you die.
Amen.
Aha! Because you understand death to sin. Talk to me. May you die to sin.
Amen.
That's it. Those who are struggling to overcome sin have not yet died. That's it. Dying to sin will free you from sin. But the death that he died to sin once. How many times?
Once.
That's sufficient. Once he has died, he's not going to die no more. He has died for you. So Jesus Christ is not coming back again to save us. He has saved us. Amen. He's only coming back to take us home.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
For the death that he died to sin. How many times?
Once.
And for him, how many people?
For all.
For the whole world. But the life that he lives. So Jesus is alive.
Amen.
Amen. Because death has been swallowed up in victory.
Amen.
But the life that he lives, that's in present tense continuum. So he's alive. The life that he lives to God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
One translation reads, when he died once to break the power of sin. But now that he lives for the glory of God. May you live for God's glory.
Amen.
At your workplace, he wants to live for his glory.
Amen.
In your neighborhood, he wants to live for his glory. Therefore, you must talk to every neighbor about Christ. The other day, last Saturday or so, when we went on the evangelism, which day was it, Sister Paula?
Friday.
Yeah. We went on evangelism, and then near where I was in the rain, dancing in the rain there, my neighbor, all the man, the woman, the three children came out. Two children. Maybe he's three now, I don't know. with the two children. And they are my neighbor. You say, I said, my neighbor. Jesus knows. That was it. And you got to chat. If I've been living a double life, that So it's down to you and I not to play religion. Be real. Talk to somebody, say
be real.
So you also need to die to break the power of sin over you. He that has died is freed. Until you die, you are not free. Remember that scripture, he that has died is free. Romans 6, 7. But he that is not dead is not free. That's why you can still say, I cannot help it. I don't want to lose my job, you see. If I don't say it now, I will be the only one out. Excuse me. You are dipping yourself more into trouble. It's the truth that you know that can make you free.
Yes.
The truth you don't know about or you want to cover up cannot make you free.
Yes.
Anyway, unless you die to sin, sin will not let you go. Christ died once to make you and I free from the choices of sin. I need to tell you this so that you can know the life that I live. I need to tell you this because this is what has changed my life and is still changing my life. The other day, sister was asking us, you guys are rehab on Friday. I don't know what you. What, I don't know how the sister Leonie said it. So what, you guys, I don't know what you are doing there, but I know God is there. I'm looking for God. So that, how did she say? How did she say? Tell me. So you guys, how did she say? How did they say it?
I said, but I don't really know what to say.
I know. I don't know you, what you guys are looking
what
for.
What I mean was, I think one of the bits I said was that you two, I don't know what you thought, but you two, your hearts are right.
Right.
And this place is alive. I don't know if it's relevant, but that's why I want all people to come.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
I want God to bless you two.
Yeah.
I know that. I don't know if that's what you mean.
Yeah, no, it's okay. What I just pick up is that what you guys are doing here, kind of a thing that is kind of, it must be God in a way. I said, well, that's God. But well, the beautiful thing is that the Holy Spirit spoke through you to say the right thing in the sense that except you have this life of God in you, you cannot do what these people are doing. You see? And that's the prayer that she was praying, that she prayed that other people will come to receive the life.
Yes.
But this life, somebody paid for it.
Yes.
You might have people in the church, a lot of people, but they don't have the life.
Mm.
It's a waste.
Mm. That's true.
So sin will prevent you from living for the glory of God. Apostle Paul said in Galatians, it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. Everybody say
Christ
lives
in me.
That's it. When Christ is living in you, wow, it will help you to make the right choice.
Amen.
Freedom from sin. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us. Jesus did not sin. But God put our sins on him. Why? That we might become the righteousness of God in him. The new life is only in him, in Christ. Christ became the substitute. Everyone say substitute.
Substitute.
Christ became the substitute for our punishment. Prophet Isaiah said, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people, he was stricken. Yet it pleased the Lord, God the Father, to bruise him. Why? Apostle Paul said, that we might become the righteousness of God. That we might become right before God.
Amen.
You cannot become right if not Christ that has made us right. Freedom from sin. When he knew that it was time for him to be arrested and crucified on the cross, Jesus said to his disciples, John chapter 12, verses 23 to 24, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. There is glory in death. There is glory in death. When you choose to die to self, there is glory in it. Dying to sin is glorious. Most assuredly, Jesus said, what is the synonym? What is the synonym for this phrase? Most assuredly.
Very, very,
very. Very, very.
Certainly.
Certainly.
Undoubtedly.
Undoubtedly. How about being certain? How about being verily, verily? How about being undoubtedly in your relationship with God? You know, you can become so certain in your faith with God. That's what I'm asking you to consider today. And you can only do that when you die to sin. Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains out alone. This tells me that if you ever felt lonely and alone in this world, it is primarily your own making. Because it is also in your power to stop loneliness by being productive. One translation reads, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. Everybody say single seed.
Single seed.
That's why some people are still single. It remains a single seed, but if it dies, it produces many seeds. Your choice to sin will stop your progress in life. But if you turn around and die daily to sin, nothing can stop your progress in life. Freedom from sin. Luke chapter 18, as I begin to round up quickly. Luke chapter 18, verse 18. Are you getting something? Say amen.
Amen.
Luke chapter 18, verse 18, please. Now a certain ruler asked him, Jesus, saying, good teacher, that's another reference for Jesus, good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? This is the very question many today are still demanding an answer. You might be in the church, they are still asking, what can I do to inherit eternal life? Mm-hmm. You know, the wages of sin is what?
Death.
But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. What must you do to get it? Not just coming to church will give it to you. Not being a member of the church will give it to you. But try being a citizen of the kingdom of God. Then you will get it. It's about a life-changing decision. You must make up your mind to get it. Eternal life is not for everyone. It is for whoever believes in him, the begotten Son of the Father. Whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Eternal life will cost you. The life you know you should live, but you are not yet living that life, is because you are not ready to pay the price. It will cost you. Jesus paid for it, didn't he? why can't you also give your life to it? This is a message you continue to hear in this church. It's what makes us different from others. Verse 23. Now that the man knew that it will cost him, see what he did. When he heard, verse 23, when he heard this, the rich man, he became very sorrowful, for he was very rich. The rich man, upon hearing that it will cost him to get this eternal life, he became sorrowful. Brothers and sisters, it will cost you to be freed from sin. Some wants God and still want to live their lives as they want. It will cost you. You know, I think there's an English phrase that says you cannot eat your cake and still have it. Some people want to eat their cake and still have it. It doesn't work that way. The life you know you should live, but you are not ready to live it. What the life you know you have to live, but what you are doing now is stopping you from living that life. You have to make your choice whether to drop what you are doing now so that you can have eternal life, or not drop what you are doing now and still be pretending that you have eternal life. You cannot be freed from sin and still be living in sin. It doesn't make sense. How can you, we that have died to sin, continue to be living in sin? God forbid. Certainly not. He that has died to sin is freed from sin. If you are still struggling to obey God, to give your tithe, to witness to people, to pray, to study your Bible, to go on a mission, it means that you don't have the life you're talking about. You don't have the life that we're talking about. If you are not yet determined to serve God, then you are still a slave of sin. And so many slaves of sin are in the church. Just going to church is not enough. I hear that says, so I go to church. That's not enough. You can go to church, but you are not living the life. So what has the church got to do? Nothing. You're just playing religion. But when you go to church and you are living the life, then people can see the life in you, and then that can draw them to God, then you're on the right path. Lastly, Romans 10:13. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whoever. So it's not for everyone, it's for whoever. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Not the one that still eats their cake or has still want to have it. You know? Salvation is for whoever. So are you hearing this message and you want to be saved? Then you will be. Let us pray. Talk to God. You know if you are saved or not. You know if you are hiding or not. Whoever will believe will be saved. Therefore, are you still living in sin? Little lie. There's nothing little about lies. There's nothing little about telling lies. A little lie is a lie. And a big one is also a lie. It's better not to tell a lie at all. Yes, and it's possible only in Christ. He that has died to sin is freed from sin. All those little choices that you make that are not totally true, you know you can be free from them. If only you can choose to die daily to sin. I'm asking someone here to make the right choice, make the right decision. Stop beating about the bush. You know what is right to do. That is why God has brought you here right now. That is why God has made you to be watching this message on the news right now. Watching this on the YouTube or wherever media you are using is for you to make that choice, that decision. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ. For God so loved the world. He loved the world. And he gave his only begotten son. That whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. When you have died to sin, you come alive in God. Is there anyone here that is ready to die to sin? The same way Jesus Christ voluntarily died on the cross. He surrendered himself, his life, as a ransom to purchase us, to give us life. He knew what he did. No one forced him to do that. It was his option. It was his choice. You too must choose to die to sin. It's your choice. No one will force you. You are not hearing this message here because you are being forced. No. It has to be your own choice. Is there someone here that wants to make that choice for God? Stand on your feet. Is there someone here that wants to make that choice in the presence of the saints, in the presence of God himself, to say, I want to die to self from now on. I want to live for Christ. Paul said, the life I now live, I live by the faith in the Son of God who died and gave himself for me. Who is that one? Stand on your feet. Wherever you are. With every eye closed, mind your business. With every head bowed, you stand on your feet if you are the one. And begin to ask the Lord to have mercy on you. That the life that you have been living is not right, you know. But now you want to make it right about all. You don't want to be playing religion anymore. You want to be in Christ. Therefore, you are voluntarily surrendering your life so that you can pick up the life of Christ. Stand on your feet, down. And begin to ask him to forgive you. You might hide. You might keep quiet. But God knows who you are. But you will live here today with a guilty conscience. But if I were you, I will answer that God. Say, God, I surrender all. The life I've been living is a life full of sin. I want to make a right about talk. I'm just going to church. Going to church. No, I don't want that. I really want to make a choice to stand for you. Make that choice right now. Stand on your feet. And ask him to save you. And give you that choice. Give you that life that is only available in Christ. Begin to talk to him, those that are standing. Begin to ask him to forgive you. Now I have shown you life and death. But I rather want you to choose life. If you are going to choose this life, you have to make a commitment to understand the word of God. To daily conscientiously study the word of God. To daily commit yourself to church business. To daily be a soul winner. To look for opportunity to share this good news to others. If you are making that commitment, I want to ask him to give you the grace to do that. He gives grace. He gives more grace. Let God give you the grace to live above sin. So that sin will not have dominion over you. In your mind, in your thoughts level, will not be filthy anymore. Ask him to begin to sanitize your mind. Clean your mind with the word of God. Make a conscious effort that I will daily study the word of God. Pastor recommend the book study. I will begin from the gospel according to St. John. On a daily basis with my writing material, I want God to speak to me. Make that your decision now. The youth, the adult, the older one particularly. Make that choice. Because every day people are dying, leaving this world. Physical death. They don't know where they are going. They don't know where they're going. They don't know. They found themselves in that eternity. Eternity. For some is eternal life, for others is eternal death. Which one will you pick? Talking to the elder one, to the elders among us. Which one will you pick? It's not just a church member. I'm an elder. No, you have to live right. Live right. I don't want to be a pastor that will miss God, that will miss heaven. If I don't live right, I cannot preach right. It's because I am living this life, and this is the life of Christ in me. My wife, my children know this is my life. What about you? Make that choice to live this life. To live this life of God. Start living this life of God. Talk to Him that He will give you the grace to be obedient to Him. Prayer meeting, you will attend it. You too want to pray to heaven. Bible study, you will attend it because you want to know the Bible. Sunday school, on Sunday, you will attend it because you want to be a member. You want to be active in the Sunday school. Talk to Him. Then your life will begin to change. Lord, we thank you. Let's begin to thank God. Let me begin to thank you. Lord, bless you. Lord, bless you. Let everybody stand on their feet, please. And we can thank you. All to Jesus I surrender.
God is still demanding a change for me.
How is it? Listen, listen, don't pray, don't pray, don't pray, listen. It's your conscience gripping you right now, pricking you. In that area, that is where God wants you to surrender. You know you can live free from guilt conscience. That is the new life. I'm living free of guilt conscience. I want you to live free from guilt conscience. Now, if your conscience is pricking you right now, that is the area God is demanding a change from you. I want you to make a decision right now. He wants you to die to sin so I can be free from that sin. Ask him to give you the grace to do it now. If you ask him and you're genuine about it, he will give you. Then you will enjoy this eternal life I'm talking about. This is not church. This is relationship with God. This is life. The new and living way in Christ Jesus. And if your conscience has not pricked and has stopped pricking you, rather, why don't you begin to enjoy? Enter into that life. To increase in that life. This is a time that gifts are given by God. This is a time that vision for life are shown. This is a time that God calls you into work, relationship with him. This is a time that he will show you the things to come. Anyone? It's by faith. And if God is asking you to see me after the service, wait behind. And make sure we talk together. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we bless you. Give you praise. So, Father, thank you for your word.
Thank you.
In the entrance of your word, give light.
Yes.
Understanding to the simple. Jesus Christ said, I am the light of the world.
Yes.
No one. If anyone will walk after me, will follow after me. If anyone will follow after me, if is a choice. If anyone will follow after me, if anyone will study his Bible daily, and carry his cross daily, if anyone will follow after me, he will not walk in darkness, but shall receive the light of life.
Amen.
Welcome to life.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you. Help us to grow in life, to grow in your Zoe life.
Amen.
For many that have stood up, regardless of the people looking at them, they have stood up, they are not ashamed to stand up for Christ. For those that have stood up for Christ, Lord, thank you for giving them a standing ovation.
Amen.
Jesus Christ stood up for Stephen when Stephen was being stoned. Jesus Christ stood up and gave him a standing ovation. Lord, thank you for those people.
Amen.
We now pray for grace to make them planted.
Amen.
In your work.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we have prayed.
Yeah.
Come on, clap your hands. Amen.